شاء الله.
سورة الحجرات. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله واتقوا الله إن الله سميع عليم. This is an amazing surah. It's a surah in which Allah teaches us how to behave towards people outwardly and inwardly. It's a surah that teaches us about inner beauty, about inner purification, about purifying our behavior towards Muslims, purifying our thoughts about Muslims and our attitudes towards people. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who have iman. A companion once said that when I hear Allah saying Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, I become alert. You know, like someone calls out your name and you'll instinctively turn around to see who's calling me. If it's the voice of someone you love, you'll turn immediately to hear what is it that this person is going to tell you. Now this is Allah, Malikul Muluk, and He is addressing all of us. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who have iman, who say the kalima la ilaha illallah. What is it that Allah wants of us? Do not be hasty before Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's presence. Wattaqullah, and fear Allah. Indeed Allah is all hearing, all knowing. Now what does this mean? What is the meaning of this ayat? The surah opens with Allah's command to the believers not to interrupt the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's conversation or to contradict him. Now you might say, well, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is no longer amidst us. So how can we apply this ayat to ourselves? Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu added a greater dimension to this verse and said, it means that do not say anything which goes against the Quran or the Sunnah. See, for instance, sometimes we let our culture take precedence over a command of the Quran. For instance, let's look at an example from our own society. We all know that generally women are deprived of their inheritance rights. Now if you ever try telling men that and you say, well, it's in the Quran, they know it's in the Quran. Yet they say, well, what will the women do with these inheritance rights? And it's always been done. See, when we give our culture or our own desires precedence over Allah's command and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's command, then that is blasphemy and that negates our iman. And it's not just about Allah, it's not just in the Quran. Like people say, oh well, it's not in the Quran, is it? No, we find it applies to the Sunnah as well. Do you know that Hazrat Umar did not like his wife going to the mosque? He didn't feel comfortable with it. But he did not forbid her. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had once said, do not forbid Allah's maidservants from going to the mosque. Now how many of us would do that? That if we're not comfortable with something, but when we read Allah's command and we read the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's command and we give that precedence over our own desires and our own cultures. Wattaqullah, and be conscious of Allah. Don't come forward with your own interpretation of deen. Don't come forward with your own interpretation of sunnah, doing what you will, following your own whims. Wattaqullah, be careful, be conscious that Allah is watching you. Inna Allaha Samiun Alim. Allah can hear your excuses. He can hear whatever it is that you're claiming, that no, this has always been done and we can't change it now. Alim, He knows the truth of the situation. Ya ayyuhallazina amanu. Again Allah repeats, so that we remain attentive, we remain alert, we don't sit back and relax. O you who have iman, la tarfa'u aswatakum fawqa sawti an-nabi. Now this is a natural sequence of ayat number 1. Allah says, don't interpret it according to your own whims and desires. And now Allah says, don't raise your voices above the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What does this mean? We look at the words of the verse. How do they apply to us? Do not raise your voices above the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That when we hear a hadith which we know is accurate, we accept it. Many people nowadays say, well, the word haram has not been used for wine in the Quran. And you tell them it's been used in the Sunnah, they say, well, it's not in the Quran, is it? For any Muslim to take his own interpretation of the Quran and place it before the hadith, this is what Allah is talking about. Don't raise your voices above the voice of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. وَلَا تَجْهَرُوا لَهُ بِالْقَوْلِ. And do not speak aloud to him in talk as you speak aloud to one another. And Allah says, لا تجهروا له بالقول. Now this also means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that don't raise your voices near the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we find that when we look at the great scholars of Islam, we find the reverence and the deference they had for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was just unparalleled. See, not just the companions who lived with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On one occasion, this delegate from, I think it was one of the Roman emperors, came, and when he saw the way the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam adored him, he said, never have I seen such love. Never. Now we find that amongst the great scholars, people like Imam Malik, that on one occasion, Imam Malik was relating a hadith and his face started turning yellow. And the people couldn't understand what was wrong, but he continued. And afterwards they realized that he had been stung by a scorpion. Yet he kept on speaking out of love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do you know he never wore shoes in Medina? And when he would come to teach a hadith, he would wear his best clothes. And people would say, isn't this vanity? He said, no, this is love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We cannot even understand such an attitude nowadays. We who just make fun of everything. We make fun of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's sunnah. We make fun of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's ahadith. We make fun of the fact that he had so many wives, na'uzubillah. Allah says, لا تجهروا له بالقول. Don't treat him like an ordinary human being, someone that is on your level. Who is he? He is Khatamun Nabiyyin. He is the seal of all the prophets. What is the danger of all this? أَمْ تَحْبَطَ أَعْمَالُكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. Lest your deeds be wiped out and you don't even realize. Now the word used here is wiped out. You know, like when a virus attacks your computer and everything goes. تَحْبَطَ أَعْمَالُكُمْ. The companions used to weep when they would read this ayat. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once said that avoid loud talk. And he said, if you get angry, be quiet. This ayat is teaching us respect and courtesy and behavior towards people. And he once said that raised voices are amongst the signs of the last day. And he said voices will be raised aloud in the mosques. And tribes will be led by their most sinful members. And look at our mosque today. Fighting going on, killing taking place. Now the key word here is, وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. That is the true tragedy. You don't even realize it. Now how frightening that you're doing good deeds, you're reading prayers, you're giving zakat, you're reading the Quran, and you're complacently relying upon that. And one word against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or one word which is displeasing to Allah. And on that day of judgment, when we reach there, confidently relying upon our good deeds, and you discover an empty slate, أَمْ تَحْبَطَ أَعْمَالُكُمْ. Don't you realize how serious it is? Your deeds could be wiped out. وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. You don't even realize it. The Prophet ﷺ once said, a man may inadvertently speak a word pleasing to Allah, because of which Jannah is destined for him. And another may recklessly speak a word displeasing to Allah, because of which he will be cast in hellfire further than the distance between heaven and earth. May Allah protect us and may Allah teach us to guard our speech. Every word we utter could be for us or against us. وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. And we don't even realize it. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَغُضُّونَ أَصْوَاتَهُمْ عِنْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Indeed, those who lower their voices in the presence of Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are the ones whose hearts Allah has tested for piety. For them is forgiveness and a beautiful reward. People who hear the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and who accept his verdict as the final verdict, Allah says, they are the ones whose hearts Allah has tested for piety. For them is forgiveness and a beautiful reward. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُنَادُونَكَ مِن وَرَاءِ الْحُجُرَاتِ. Indeed those who call you from behind the dwellings, most of them have no sense. See, I mentioned earlier that the surah teaches us courtesy. What happened was that whenever the Bedouins wanted to speak to the Prophet ﷺ, they'd just run around his apartment bellowing out, Ya Muhammad, ukhruj, come out of Muhammad, come out of Muhammad ﷺ. And this was so displeasing to Allah that Allah says those who call out to you from behind the dwellings, they're just not using their brains. And had they had patience till you could have come out to them, it would have been better for them. وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. And Allah is forgiving. Allah is most merciful. See, we can apply this ayah to ourselves as well. That when someone starts serving Islam or any Muslim leader, people assume that he's become public property. And they can ring him up all times of the day. They can bug him whatever times they want for their problems. Allah does not like such selfishness. Allah says, no, leave them with their privacy. When they come out to you, then ask them your problems. Wallahu ghafoor rahim. If you've done this in the past, Allah will forgive you as long as you desist. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. Again Allah says, wake up people, become alert. O you who believe, if Allah comes to you with any news, verify it, lest you should harm people in ignorance. We find that later on all members of the Mustalik tribe were freed. This was a Jewish tribe. And the Prophet ﷺ invited the leader of the tribe to accept Islam. And then he told him to invite the rest of his tribe to Islam and collect zakat from the Muslims. So this leader Al-Haris agreed and he asked the Prophet ﷺ to send a messenger to collect the zakat. Now when the time came and the messenger still hadn't come, Al-Haris feared that maybe the Prophet ﷺ was angry with him. So he sent a delegation to the Prophet to find out the reason for the delay. In the meantime, the Prophet ﷺ had sent a Muslim by the name of Al-Walid bin Uqba to collect the zakat. Now on his way, Walid heard that a group from Bani Mustalik had set out. Without bothering to find out the truth of the situation, he became frightened and he returned to the Prophet ﷺ and exaggerated and said, you know, Haris threatened to kill me and he said, I'm not going to give the zakat. So the Prophet ﷺ was naturally angry and he sent a group of companions to deal with Haris. When they met and they returned to the Prophet ﷺ, he asked Al-Haris, why did you refuse to pay the zakat and kill my messengers? And Al-Haris replied, by Allah, I did not see him. I never even met this man and he's just made it up. Now this incident was very important because Allah says, O you who believe, if a liar comes to you with any news, verify it, lest you should harm people in ignorance. And afterwards, you become regretful for what you have done. Now we can apply this ayah to ourselves. That when someone comes to us with a piece of news, we need to look at the nature of the person who's telling us. See, we're a people who adore spreading false rumors and we're a people who love exaggerating. We hear one thing and we'll add 10 things onto it. Allah says, if a liar, not if a non-Muslim or a kafir or a hypocrite, if a liar, someone you know is unreliable, comes to you with a piece of news, first verify the truth. Someone comes to you and says, you know, so-and-so is saying this about you. Don't just go up in flames, find out the truth first. Lest you should harm people in ignorance, lest your relationship is ruined forever. And afterwards you become regretful for what you have done. Allah teaches the Muslims not to be hasty and impetuous. It says in a hadith, impatience is from shaitan. So the Muslim is supposed to be calm and deliberate in all his actions. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. And know that among you there is the Messenger of Allah. If he were to obey you in much of the matter, you would surely be in trouble. But Allah has endeared the faith to you and has beautified it in your hearts and has made disbelief, wickedness and disobedience hateful to you. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الرَّاشِدُونَ. Such are they who are the rightly guided. Now Allah is telling us that people, deen is not about your desires. It's not about the way you want to interpret it. It's about Muhammadur Rasulullah. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam alone can interpret this deen for us. See, people love to introduce new things into Islam and when you tell them about it, they become offended. For instance, you tell people that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam never celebrated his birthday. This custom of Eid Miladun Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a bid'ah, it's an innovation. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said once, whoever introduces something new into this religion of ours, which does not belong in it, will have it rejected. Now if people are sitting there at that milad, chanting naats and thinking that this is a part of Islam, and this is something that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did, this is wrong. And we need to know that. And we find that many of the naats are mushrikana. Then the people stand up for the salam and they say, oh, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's spirit is passing by. Allah says, if the Prophet were to follow you in much of the matter, if your desires were what it was all about, you would surely be in trouble. Everyone with their own slant, with their own bias, their own prejudices. But Allah has made the faith beautiful to you. And He has beautified it in your hearts. Now let's think about it. Let's everyone analyze themselves. Is Iman something beautiful for us? Is our Iman something precious? Something that we need to value, something that we need to cherish, As Allah tells us, Hafizu ala salawat, protect your prayers. Is that how we view iman, or is it more like a burden? This oppressive burden that now I know I have to act upon this, and now I know that I have to act upon this as well. It's a matter of attitude. See, Allah doesn't say that Allah knows that you're obeying Him. Allah says, Allah has endeared the faith to you. So we need to purify our hearts as well. At-taqwa hahuna. This is where Allah consciousness is found, in your heart. And Allah has beautified it. And He has made disbelief, wickedness and disobedience hateful to you. Are we like that? Is that what our loves and our hatreds are about? أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الرَّاشِدُونَ. For such people are the rightly guided. This is a grace from Allah and His favor. And Allah is all-knowing. Allah is all-wise. The Prophet ﷺ once said, there are three qualities for which anyone who has them will experience the sweetness of iman. What are these? He who loves a human being for Allah's sake alone, and he who has as great a hatred of returning to disbelief after Allah has rescued him from it as he has of being cast into the fire. Is that how we view iman? And Allah goes on to say, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا. If two parties among the believers fall to fighting, then make peace between them both. Now we can understand this ayat on an individual scale. Whether your friends are fighting, or your college mates are fighting, or your colleagues are fighting, or a collective group of Muslims are fighting, or a Muslim country is fighting another Muslim country. If two parties among the believers fall to fighting, what's the first step? فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. Make peace between them both. That is the first consideration. But if one of them outrages against the other, then fight against the one, that which outrages, till it complies with the command of Allah. One of them, suppose, is determined, no, I'm not going to accept and I'm going to go on fighting, then we have to check that oppression. Not that we sit by and watch Muslims kill one another. See, the Prophet ﷺ once said, "Unsur akhaka zaliman aw mazluman." Help your brother, whether he is doing wrong or being wrong. And the people were amazed and said, how do we help the zalim? How do we help someone who is doing wrong? And he said, by stopping him in his wrong. And then if it complies, then make reconciliation between them justly. Now there are three steps. The first step is that you make peace between them. Second step is, if one party is not agreeing, then you force them to agree. And the third step is that peace is made justly, not on the basis of your prejudices or your dislikes. See, when we fight someone, we forget all their good points. Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. Be just, because truly Allah loves those who are just. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. Indeed, the believers are brothers. So make reconciliation between your brothers and fear Allah. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. So that you may receive mercy. Please highlight this ayat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the Muslims are brothers. He once said that for a Muslim, another Muslim's blood and his wealth and his honor are haram. They are sacred. In other words, it's haram for a Muslim to kill another Muslim. It's haram for a Muslim to steal from or cheat another Muslim. And it's haram for a Muslim to talk about another Muslim's honor or reputation. Allah says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. The believers are brothers. On one occasion, the Prophet ﷺ said that the Muslims are like two hands washing each other. And that's such a beautiful metaphor. That they complement one another, they support one another. He said the believers are like one structure, each part supporting the other. And he warned us, Allah helps his slave only as long as the slave helps his brother. Now look at the way the ayat ends. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. If you wish for mercy, we complain and we say, why isn't Allah showing the Muslims mercy? Why are the Muslims world losers? Because we're not acting upon this ayah. Because we're not brothers. Because we don't care about each other. We're not supporting each other. We're not helping each other, whether materially, financially or spiritually. Allah says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. The believers are brothers. Now if you look at the rituals in Islam, we find that they all have a collective aspect. So you can read Salat in your home, but if you read Salat in the mosque, the reward is much greater. Now what happens when you're reading collective prayers in the mosque? You're standing together. Not one gap is being left in between. It's forbidden to leave a gap in between. Why? إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. Because the believers are brothers. And when you're standing together with someone and you're praying, then you feel that sense of unity and that feeling of, you know, reverence when you go down in sajda. And if you've ever had the chance of praying in the Kaaba and you're praying on the roof and all those Muslims standing together, if you look at Hajj, what do we find? Rich, poor, black, white, male, female, and all the men wearing just the same garment. Why? إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. The believers are brothers. Look at zakat. Zakat isn't that you just go and give some money, you know, and put it in one corner of the room. What does zakat entail? That you go out, find the Muslims who are suffering, find the Muslims who are needy. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. The believers are brothers. And when they forget this brotherhood, what happens? Chaos and disintegration. What has Allah told us in Surah Saff? إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِهِ صَفًّا. Allah loves those who fight in His path together, in rows upon rows, with unity, with discipline, and with harmony. And fear Allah, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. If you wish for mercy, then this is the path towards mercy. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after telling us our outward relationships, now Allah concentrates upon the more hidden aspects of our dealings with each other. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا يَسْخَرْ قَوْمٌ مِّنْ قَوْمٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُونُوا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ وَلَا نِسَاءٌ مِّنْ نِسَاءٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُنَّ. Highlight this ayat. O you who have iman, let not a group make fun of another group. Now qawmun, anonymous, it could be anyone. It could be rich people making fun of poor people. It could be relatives making fun of some other relatives. It could be strangers. Qawmun, anyone. Let not any group make fun of another group, whether rich or poor, or male or female. وَلَا نِسَاءٌ مِّن نِسَاءٍ. And let not women make fun of other women. Women are mentioned specifically here because this is one of the pastimes we delight in. Why? عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُنَّ. Maybe they are better than them. Now, we say that, well, what's the harm in a little bit of harmless gossip? And, you know, I don't mean any evil by it. When do we make fun of someone? When we despise them. When in our heart of hearts we think that I'm better than she is. Now, this form of pride is the satanic pride. أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْهُ. That's what got Shaitan. What got him? One sentence. أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْهُ. I am better than Adam. So I don't need to bow down before them. This is what Allah is highlighting here. عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُنَّ. Maybe these women, who might not be as well-dressed, or as sophisticated, or as educated, or as articulate as you, maybe they're better than you in Allah's eyes. And Allah knows, and we do not know. وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. And Allah goes on to say, and do not defame one another. Now this is something that's very important for us to understand. Slander is our favorite pastime. Look at our scandal sheets and our tabloids, conjectures, theories, and, you know, malicious stories about each other. The Prophet ﷺ told us, whoever covers the faults of a Muslim, Allah will cover his faults on the Day of Judgment. On another occasion, he said, each of us is the mirror of his brother. So if he sees any fault in him, he should wipe it away. Now Allah says, first Allah talks about derision. And this derision can be done in any way, whether you're imitating someone, you're mimicking someone, you're gesturing at someone, one lift of the eyebrow, one wink at another person can convey volumes, as we women well know. Allah says, all of this is forbidden. It's disliked by Allah. Whether you're making fun of someone or you're maliciously attacking someone, وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ. One step further, and don't give each other cruel nicknames. Now, these cruel nicknames, we find that if you're giving someone a nickname out of affection, that's allowed. The Prophet ﷺ himself named his companion Abdul Rahman ibn Sakhar. Do you know who he was? Abu Huraira, the father of the kitten. Why? Because he loved cats. He named Hazrat Ali once Abu Turab, father of the dust, out of love, because Hazrat Ali had been lying in the dust and he'd gotten dusty. That's allowed. وَلَا تَنَابَسُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ. Don't give each other cruel nicknames that hurt people, even if they don't show it. بِئْسَ الْإِسْمُ الْفُسُوقُ بَعْدَ الْإِيمَانِ. Now you might say, well, what's the big deal? Just one word, just a bit of harmless gossip. I didn't do anything to her. Allah says, how evil is the word of sin How evil is it to insult one's brother after having iman? In other words, iman and derision and malice and mockery do not go together. Now we can choose right now whether we want iman in our hearts or we want these qualities, these malicious qualities within us. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَتُوبْ And whoever does not repent, from what? From these deeds. فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ Such people are the wrongdoers. And who is the greatest zalim? The one who is doing injustice to himself. So if you are making fun of someone, what happens on the day of judgment? Either you get some of their sins or some of your good deeds go to them. They have not suffered. We are the ones who have suffered. مَنْ لَمْ يَتُوبْ Whoever doesn't stop doing all this, such are the zalimun. The Prophet ﷺ once asked, Do you know who the truly bankrupt person is? And the companion said, Well, one who has no money. He said, No, one who comes on the day of judgment, he will have good deeds. And then the people will start coming forward. People whom he's insulted, people whom he might have gossiped about, people whom he might have hurt. And they'll start taking his good deeds, one by one by one. Now just imagine it. Just imagine how intolerable it would be that you reach there on the day of judgment. Every deed is precious. Every deed could be the deed that takes you to Jannah. And you watch it being taken away? For what? Just for that one harmless piece of gossip? For that one word of derision? For that one look that you gave to your friend? That one raised eyebrow? And you see your precious salat being given to that person? You see your precious taraweeh being given away? That taraweeh which took you so much time and effort and you see it being given away? For what? For one moment? Is it worth it? مَنْ لَمْ يَتُوبْ Whoever doesn't stop, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ Such are the wrongdoers. Let's make a pledge to Allah that Allah guard us from such evil speech and anything that will offend you or will take our good deeds away. See, the Prophet ﷺ said, the believers whose faith is most perfect are those who have the best character. Sometimes we think we're reading so much of the Quran and we're doing so much for Allah, we can do what we like to people. If you think about the obsession these days, especially there's this obsession with externals and with physical beauty, and your figures have to be perfect and your skin has to be perfect and your faces have to be perfect. Allah is talking about inner beauty here. Because remember, our spiritual condition in this world is our physical condition in the next. يَوْمَ تَسْوَدُّ وُجُوهُ وَتَبْيَضُّ وُجُوهُ On the day some faces will be radiant and some faces will be dark. That inner venom, that inner malice will all be shown on their faces. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Wake up, O believers! O you who believe, اِجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ Avoid suspicion. Shun suspicion. Why? إِنَّ بَعْضُ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٌ Because some suspicions are sins. First, Allah speaks about the obvious forms whereby you're deriding someone, you're making fun of someone. Then Allah says, what about the hidden thoughts that nobody knows of but us? And the first step is suspicion. So you go into a room and you see two people talking and they look at you and they're quiet and you go, they must have been talking about me. That's the first step. Then what happens? وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا Don't start probing and spying. Have you ever heard her talk against me? And you're asking everyone she knows. Have they ever said anything about me? Then what happens? وَلَا يَخْطَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا Do not backbite each other. And then you say, well, if she's been talking about me, I know 20 things about her. Don't backbite each other. Look at the sequence of commands. Don't suspect people. Don't assume the worst. And this is what we delight to do in. Hazrat Umar once said that if your Muslim brother makes an ambiguous statement to you, you should only think the best and you will find a good explanation for it. Like when you go home and you start brooding, now what did she mean by that? Must have been something bad, must have been an insult. He said think the best. And the Prophet ﷺ tried to warn us lest such situations arise, and that's why he once said, two people should not converse privately with each other in the presence of a third. اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظني Because this is a sin. This is forbidden, to think evil of the people around you. وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا Don't start spying on people, gossiping, reading their letters, eavesdropping. You pick up the phone and it's a cross line. Hey, that's really interesting now. Or you're reading their letters or you find someone's diary and you eagerly read it, asking the children, asking the servants. لَا تَجَسَّسُوا This is beneath us. We find that on one occasion, Hazrat Umar رضي الله عنه was passing by this man's house.
And he heard these voices coming from there. So he suspected something was going on. Now being Hazrat Umar, he just leapt over the wall and barged in right in. And he saw that the man was drinking wine and there was a dancing girl there. So Hazrat Umar told him sternly, you'd better come to court tomorrow. Now when the man showed up, that man told Hazrat Umar, you know, if I committed one sin, you've committed three. And Hazrat Umar said, what? And he said, you spied on me, you jumped over my wall and you burst in without permission. And Hazrat Umar apologized to that man. La tajassasu, don't spy. Islamically we find that evidence based on spying is rejected. And then the most important one of all, wala yaghtab ba'dukum ba'da, do not backbite each other. What is backbiting? Once this man asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is backbiting? And he said, dhikruka akhaka bima yakrahu, for you to mention your brother in a way that he would dislike. And he said, well, what if what I said was true? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if what you said was true, then it's ghibat. Because if it was a lie, it's slander. Like people who love to say, you know, well, this is the truth and I'm telling you the truth. Go and ask her if you don't believe me. This is ghibat. To say anything about your brother which they would dislike. Look at the beautiful, subtle definition. It's not something which is untrue or something that is, you know, wrong. It's something which they would dislike. Allah is saying, put yourself in the other person's shoes. How would you like to have someone say that about you? For instance, we find that once a woman visited Hazrat Aisha, and when the woman got up to leave, Hazrat Aisha just made a sign with her hand, indicating that that woman was short. And the Prophet ﷺ immediately reprimanded her and said, you have just done ghibat. And think of our conversations, and our gestures, and our comments, which we pass blindly, recklessly, without caring. But now why is this so sick? Allah says, أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَن يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا. Would any one of you love to eat the flesh of your dead brother? فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. You would be sickened by it. The flesh of your dead brother. God forbid if someone's brother were to even die. Even that's such a frightening thought. For those of us who have brothers. But this is for you to be eating. For you to be feeding upon the carcass of your dead brother. Why dead? Just as a dead person can't stop you. The person doesn't even know you're doing ghibat. He doesn't even know you're talking against them or saying something about them which they dislike. Allah says this is how sick it is. This is how it should fill you with repulsion. Why? Why brother? إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَى. The believers are brothers. فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. You would find it sick. You'd be nauseated by the sight. That's what ghibat is in Allah's eyes. Remember the hadith, one word which we might recklessly speak and it casts us deep into the depths of hellfire. And one word which could take us to Jannah. Now right now the choice is ours. Whether we wish to purify our conversations or we want to go on having that bit of harmless gossip. One more word about this ayat. Once this man was stoned to death for zina. Now this is a very important example. And there were two men passing by and they commented on it and they said what a wicked man he was. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't say anything and they went further on and there was the carcass of a donkey, the stinking carcass of a donkey. And they said, do you want to eat it? And they said, of course not, a Prophet of Allah. He said, eat it, for what you were saying just now was even worse. Now this is a man who had committed adultery. He had sinned and he had been punished for that. But once someone has been punished, we have no right to pass judgments about it and we have no right to make statements about it. This was what the Prophet ﷺ told them. Now there are certain situations where we have to speak out against a fellow Muslim. What are those? For instance, if a fatwa, if the judge has to give a verdict against a murderer or against a criminal, he can't just say, well, I'm not going to speak out against a fellow Muslim and too bad that he's a murderer and, you know, may Allah reform him. That's not allowed. Now if you have to give testimony in a court of law, then that's allowed. Then we find that sometimes you need to speak out for islah, for reforming people. If you're in a position where you're teaching people. For instance, we find that this Bedouin entered the mosque when everyone had been praying and then at the end he prayed, oh Allah, forgive me and forgive Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and don't forgive anyone else. Ameen. And he got up and left. Now you can imagine how angry everyone must have felt. Now if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had kept quiet about it, we'd all be praying similarly selfish du'as today. So the Prophet ﷺ just made light of it and he said, is this man more simple or is his camel? He didn't say anything nasty about him. He just taught them that, you know, he diffused the situation. That he's just said it out of simplicity and ignorance and don't be like him. Then we find that if someone comes to you for advice, For instance, you know, if someone comes to you about a marriage proposal, then you have to tell the truth. Because on one occasion, this Sahabiya came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and she asked him about two proposals she'd received, and he told her the truth of both of the men. He said, one of them is stingy and the other one beats his wife, so go for the one who is stingy. Then we find that if, for instance, you want to do business with someone, and you know, you go to someone for advice. Now the other person knows that that man is a known cheat and a known scoundrel. He goes, no, I'm sorry, I can't say anything against my fellow Muslim brother. That's not allowed. You have to tell them the truth, but keep it to yourself. Then we find that if someone's in a situation where they're being wronged, where they're being oppressed, maybe they're being abused in some way, then they have to speak out. Because Allah says that Allah does not love that evil should be uttered aloud, إِلَّا مَنْ ظُلِمْ, except the one who is wrong. But he should go to someone who can help him, who can give him practical advice and come up with a solution. Then we find that on some occasions you need to warn people. For instance, once this man was coming to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's house, and the Prophet saw him through the window and said, what an evil man. And when he entered, he was very courteous to him. So when he got up and left, Hazrat Aisha said, I don't understand the Prophet of Allah. You know, why did you tell me that about him, and why were you then so courteous to him? And he had told her that so that he could warn her. So if you see, for instance, that your child or anyone that you know or care about could be, you know, falling into the trap of someone who is evil, then you have to warn them. But say only what is strictly necessary. لَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْدُكُمْ مَعْدًا. Do not backbite one another. Look at the example Allah has used. أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ مَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا. Would any one of you wish to eat the flesh of his dead brother? Women say, what will we talk about then? There's nothing left to talk about. What did the Prophet ﷺ tell us? مِنْ حُسْنِ إِسْلَامِ الْمَرْءِ تَرْكُهُ مَا لَا يَعْنِيهِ. The beauty of a man's Islam is that he leaves that which does not concern him. Is that how dumb we are? We've got nothing else to talk about? Allah says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. Be afraid of Allah. Don't say that one word. And just you get that one moment's kick and you get that one moment of laughter and enjoyment, and on the day of judgment you see your good deeds are being handed over to that person. And when your good deeds finish, their sins are being loaded onto you. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. Fear Allah. Now what if we've done ghibat? And we've all must have done ghibat at some time or the other. What if we've done ghibat? Now what's the solution? The solution is that we pray for that person. Or we apologize to that person. Or we give a sadqah. And believe me, that will stop you from ever doing ghibat again. It's very difficult to pray for someone you dislike. So this is the cure, that if you've done ghibat about someone, then start praying for them. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. And be afraid of Allah. If your friends are doing ghibat all day long, then either change the conversation or change the friends. It's not worth it. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. Be afraid of Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. There is still time to turn to Allah. Indeed, Allah is the one who accepts repentance, the one who is the most merciful. See, we don't even know. Maybe we've given all our good deeds away to those people that we've been merrily backbiting all these years. Ya Yuhannas, O mankind. How beautiful. Allah purifies His precious believers, teaches them about inner beauty, and now Allah turns to all mankind. O mankind, إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلًا لِتَعَارَفُوا. O mankind, we have created you from a male and a female, true equality. And we have made you into nations and tribes that you may know one another. Look at the diversity of cultures, the richness of human nature that Allah has created. لِتَعَارَفُوا, that you may know one another. Not that Allah created everyone in one monotonous mold. Look at the beauty and the difference in people's colors, in their skins, in their complexions, in their languages, in their cultures. Allah says, لِتَعَارَفُوا, so that you could get to know one another. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَتْقَاكُمْ. What's the next step? You think, well, which culture is the best? Which person is the best? Which skin color is the best? Allah says, no. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The most honorable of you with Allah is the one who is the most Allah conscious. Whether he is black, whether he is poor, whether it's a woman or a man or a child, أَتْقَاكُمْ, taqwa. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam again and again warned us against racism, warned us against nationalism, saying, كُلُّكُمْ مِنْ آدَمْ وَآدَمُ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. O man, never forget that you're all from Adam, and Adam was made of dust. Indeed, Allah is all-knowing, all-aware. Say you do not believe, but only say we have surrendered. For faith has not yet entered your hearts. But if you obey Allah and His Messenger, He will not decrease anything in reward for your deeds. إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورُ رَحِيمٌ. Indeed, Allah is forgiving, most merciful. Now here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is simply mentioning the degrees of Iman. See, like we also love to call ourselves mu'mins. Allah says no, the first stage is Islam. And then it's up to you whether you wish to reach that level of Iman or not. Who are the mu'mineen then? Let's read the ayat and analyze ourselves. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. The first step, Iman. In Allah and His Messenger. ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. Then they do not doubt. No hesitation, no compromise, no apologies. وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ. They spend of their wealth. It's not just talk, they make sacrifices. وَأَنفُسِهِمْ. And their own lives, their times, their energies, their talents, their knowledge, all is given for Allah. فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. In the path of Allah, for Allah's deen. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الصَّادِقُونَ. Such are the truthful. Now we can analyze ourselves, whether we come in this category or not. Say, will you inform Allah of your religion, while Allah knows all that is in the heavens and all that is in the earth, and Allah is all aware of everything. They regard as a favor to you that they have embraced Islam. Say, do not count your Islam as a favor to me. No, but Allah has conferred a favor upon you, that He has guided you to the faith, if you indeed are true. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ غَيْبَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاللَّهُ بَصِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Indeed, Allah knows the unseen of the heavens and the earth, and Allah is the all-seer of what you do.
Turn to Allah, He's never far away. Put your trust in Him, raise your hands and pray. Ooh yeah, Allah, guide my steps, don't let me go astray. You're the only one who can show me the way. Show me the way. Show me the way. Show me the way. Inshallah.